Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Day the Bubble Burst, a social history of the Wall Street Crash of 1929, by Gordon Thomas and Max Morgan-Witts. Narrated by David Colacci. Author's Note: The Wall Street Crash of 1929 was the most climactic financial disaster in history. It still affects all our lives today. Periodically, when the market declines, the question is asked whether history will repeat itself. For a decade or more, those warning of a likely repetition have been ably led by Professor Kenneth Galbraith, whose own book on the economic background to the crash has become a standard work of reference. That other doyen of American economics, Professor Milton Friedman, sees monetarism as our financial salvation. Both agree that the 1929 crash was a financial turning point. Prior to that, the business of money was held to be the prerogative of businessmen. The crash showed how widely that prerogative had been dispersed. The crash affected everyone. It was the precursor to the Depression. As such, it was not only a financial collapse, but a human family tragedy. In a way, it was worse than war. One of those hurt explained, "In war, Dad goes off, a hero. But soon after the crash, Dad was always at home. Nagging doubts were raised. Wasn't he smart enough to get a job? Was he really trying to get work? Doubts about Dad as a person grew and remain to this day." How such a situation came to be, we have tried to explore and include. Our intention is to present for the first time a full social history of the crash and its global impact. While the boom was essentially American, the ramifications of the crash were worldwide. It is our contention that the story of the crash is best told through the lives of people, among them the people who sowed the financial whirlwind that would scatter not only them but untold others in penury. They were victims of a financial pandemic the like of which the world has never before or since seen. Previous works have tended to restrict themselves to the New York market and its immediate environs, an admirable enough decision, but one that inevitably reduced the horizon. Our journeying into the hinterlands far beyond Wall Street produced a wealth of information buried in arcane documentation, private reports, and the accounts of eyewitnesses hitherto unrecorded. While ours, too, is a financial story, it is also a social study of a unique period in history, peopled with characters rich in every sense of the word. There is Jesse Livermore, arch manipulator and nemesis of the great bull market, locked in financial combat with great bulls like John J. Raskob, Billy Durant, and Charles Mitchell. Against the background of their wheeler dealing, enough to keep most men fully occupied, Raskob is preparing his own monument, the Empire State Building. Durant is running a single-handed campaign to overthrow the policies of the Federal Reserve Board. Mitchell, chairman of America's biggest commercial bank, is, like the Artful Dodger, creating a scheme to avoid paying income tax on his millions. There is A.P. Giannini, founder of the Bank of America, hurtling around California in a Rolls-Royce dressed up as a fire truck, planning his latest moves in another great conflict, this one with the most powerful private bank in the world, the House of Morgan. There is Joe Kennedy, founder of a dynasty, self-made millionaire, determined to revenge himself on Jack Morgan, whose virtually last public appearance is with a midget in his lap. There is Henry Ford, a vowed enemy of Wall Street, unwittingly providing the fodder for Hitler's anti-Semitism. There is Clarence Hattery in London, whose ambition some believe contributed to the crash. There is Mike Meehan, who put Wall Street on the Atlantic. Talking to the sons and daughters of these men, studying their contemporary writings, their diaries and office papers, the unsuspected connections between them, the tangled web of high finance became clear. Often publicly distanced from each other, they are in the end drawn together into Wall Street by the mesmeric effect of the market. Their decision-making touched not only almost everybody in America, but also countless millions around the world. Charles Mitchell's decision to float a new bond affected the lives of Brazilian peasants. A loan from Jack Morgan helped to prop up Mussolini. Nazism grew in part because of the decision of American financiers to support the ailing Weimar Republic for profit. We have tried to look at the effects on all strata. On the one hand, there is Winston Churchill, who lost money, and a member of J.P. Morgan & Company whose wife dismisses the crash as no more than the rattle of teacups. On the other, there is a young flapper and a vivacious bootlegger, both in a sense in the market, who, like so many others, are scarred forever by men they never met and decisions over which they had no control. Few man-made events, short of the world wars, created so much pain and bitterness, and the fear it could occur again. Perhaps the only real protection against that happening is to have an understanding not only of why it happened, but of what it was like to be there when it happened. It began so promisingly, the events leading up to the day the bubble burst. G.T. M.M.W., April 1979, Ashford, Ireland. October. This is one of the peculiarly dangerous months to speculate in stocks. The others are July, January, September, April, November, May, March, June, December, August, and February. Pudd'nhead Wilson, Mark Twain. The most disastrous decline in the biggest and broadest stock market of history rocked the financial district yesterday. The New York Times, October 25th, 1929. The fundamental business of the country, that is, the production and distribution of commodities, is on a sound and prosperous basis. President Herbert Hoover, October 25th, 1929. I appeal to movie exhibitors to show pictures that will reinstate courage and hope in the hearts of the people. Jimmy Walker, Mayor of New York, October 29th, 1929. Stock prices virtually collapsed yesterday, swept downward with gigantic losses in the most disastrous trading day in the stock market's history. The New York Times, October 30th, 1929. There is nothing in the business situation to warrant the destruction of values that has taken place in the past week, and my son and I have for some days past been purchasing sound common stocks. John D. Rockefeller, Sr., October 30th, 1929. Sure he's buying. Who else has any money left? Eddie Cantor, October 31st, 1929. On Fifth Avenue, police found a parrot screaming, "More margin, more margin." Wire service report, undated, unverified. The situation has been reached in New York hotels where the clerk asks incoming guests, "You want a room for sleeping or for jumping?" And you have to stand in line to get a window to jump out of. Will Rogers, November 20th, 1929. Chapter 1. The Rampaging Bull. One whang of his hand-tooled gavel against the fluted gong would stop everything. It would end the action at Post 2, one of the stockade-shaped trading counters that had been under siege by brokers since early afternoon as U.S. Steel continued its giddy climb. It would quiet the harassed clerks inside Post 9, where Standard Oil of New Jersey, after a slow start, had suddenly outpaced the trading in Sears Roebuck, another of the Post's lively stocks. It would still the flashing numbers on the black annunciator boards which called traders to their posts for urgent messages from their offices. The gong would herald a pause for the 1,145 telephonists. It would ease the pressure on 500 page boys, 280 tube attendants and quotation clerks, 80 bond clerks, and 200 specialists clerks, essential support troops for the delicate financial maneuvers performed every minute in and around the trading posts. Walking steadily, watchfully, freezing with a glare any overactive page, nodding to the famous, proud of all he could see, William R. Crawford, superintendent of the mechanical department of the New York Stock Exchange, was acutely aware of the power embodied in his gavel. His progress across the 16,000 square feet of recently felt-padded floor, insulation that effectively reduced the noise level in the cavernous room, had all the quality of a ritual. It once led a reporter to describe Crawford as Mammon's Lord Chamberlain. The superintendent had not been amused. But he still liked to believe that the moment he used his gavel, the business of America would be fixed and frozen until the following morning. Now, as he made his measured way across the more than quarter acre of sacrosanct floor, his experienced eyes could see that it had been another highly satisfactory day for the elite in the room, the 900 brokers, each a member of the exchange and the only persons on the floor permitted to trade. At Post 1, United Aircraft was up a few points, a sign of the growing public enthusiasm for air travel. Chrysler and General Motors were trading strongly at Posts 2 and 4. Shares in the railroads, Pennsylvania, Rock Island, New York Central, New Haven, and Union Pacific, were being bought and sold briskly, as they had been for months now, every sale marking a heady profit for some investor. As usual, the biggest crowd was gathered around Post 12, the radio post, where the whiz kid of Wall Street, Michael J. Meehan, presided over the wheeling and dealing in RCA shares. Crawford was fond of saying that anybody wishing to check the pulse or the mood of America need only walk among the 18 posts. Each with its group of designated stocks reflected the unprecedented boom sweeping the nation. He believed that seeing these posts would reassure anybody that the millennium's arrived. Stocks in Woolworth, Macy, Montgomery Ward, Safeway stores, and General Foods were up, reflecting the mass marketing techniques sweeping the United States. The very name of some of the shares indicated America's belief in her global destiny. International Nickel, International Tell and Tell, International Match, International Harvester. Crawford and many others who spent their working days on the exchange floor were firmly convinced that the world outside their heavily draped sanctum depended for its prosperity on the financial juggling performed there Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and on Saturdays until noon. This Monday at 2:59 p.m., exactly on schedule, the superintendent reached a small rostrum projecting in midair from the south wall. Above him, an annunciator board continued flashing up white numbers. Flanking the board were the Stars and Stripes and the blue banner of New York State. Similar flags hung at the other end of the room. Limp and lifeless, collecting dust, the emblems were unruffled by the ebb and flow of groups of traders forming and reforming, scurrying, even at this late stage, from one post to another, buying and selling at a nod, on trust. From his pulpit, Crawford could see the strategically placed stock tickers. Recently, he had supervised the installation of ingenious reflecting devices, which threw the magnified quotations from the paper tape onto large screens visible to everyone. It was the latest in a long series of improvements that had made the New York Stock Exchange the most modern in the world. His gavel would not immediately silence the tickers. They would continue to run for some minutes afterward. How long would depend on the volume of trading in these closing seconds. Each ticker, like thousands of others linking the New York Exchange with other exchanges and brokerage offices throughout America, was under a round glass dome, not unlike the one that used to encase the wax flowers on the parlor table of Crawford's grandmother. Her grandson was responsible for the maintenance of the small brass mechanism under the glass. It was a simple enough device, two little rollers pausing as they passed through printer's ink before beating a light tattoo on the narrow strip of white tape running through a slot in the side of the dome. All over America, eager eyes perused the identical spirals of paper falling to the floor, which spelled out new highs in railways, oils, and metals. 500 miles of tape, Crawford would recite to visitors, ran over the spindles of the tickers for every million shares traded. From time to time this past year, the tickers had given news of setbacks in the market, to be swiftly followed by an even greater upsurge in value, sometimes as a result of the pools, syndicates of powerful investors, putting their huge financial resources behind a stock, spiraling it to new and dizzy heights. Day after day, a vast and growing public continued to register its faith that what goes up need not come down. The clicking of tickers had shown Americans a quick and easy road to wealth. Now, at precisely 3 p.m., this Monday, December 31st, 1928, William Crawford temporarily halted the progress down that road with a single strike of his gavel against the stock exchange gong. Another market day had ended. But this afternoon, instead of going back to their offices or to their homes, the great mass began to move purposefully across the floor, treading through thousands of canceled calculation slips and miles of discarded tape. Eagerly anticipating what lay ahead, some of the younger men broke a strict rule of the exchange. They began to run toward the doors leading to the visitors' gallery. For the past 300 minutes, the 5 hours of trading, the gallery, running along the Broad Street side of the exchange, had received a steady stream of visitors. In spite of the bitterly cold and damp weather, hundreds of people, native New Yorkers and visitors to the city, came to peer down on the trading floor, to witness for themselves the most extraordinary economic happening in the history of America, the bull market at full rampage. Throughout 1928, the double sensations of the stock market, unprecedented volume and soaring prices, had been front-page news. There had been two major breaks in June and December, but they were quickly forgotten. Day after day, month after month, the market had surged upward, carrying favorite stocks into the Empyrean. Radio Corporation of America had gone from 85 to an incredible 420 during the year. Soon it would be due for a split-up. An obscure company called Western Warehouses had leaped in similar fashion. They and the shares of 100 companies like them rose mainly because, in Crawford's opinion, the titans of the market wished them to rise. It was to catch a glimpse of those titans at work that most of the spectators in the gallery had come to the exchange. On this last day of the year, they stared down on the floor, trying to spot the men whose boldness and daring had turned them into new, authentic American heroes. The gray-uniformed guides had patiently pointed out Michael Meehan by the radio post, where the trading in RCA shares had made men, including Meehan, millions overnight, or Frank Bliss, known for his sudden, unexpected forays into the market and immortalized by the media as the Silver Fox of Wall Street. And everyone wanted to learn whether the infamous Jesse Livermore was playing the market that day. For years, the taciturn, chain-smoking New Englander, dubbed the Boy Plunger by the media, had been a living legend because of his reputation for single-handed attacks on certain stocks, pushing their price down. All day, the gallery buzzed with informed gossip. Spectators, who a year ago did not know the difference between a bear and a bull, now talked knowledgeably of selling short, as practiced by the great Livermore himself. They endlessly analyzed the current moves made by other market giants, Arthur W. Cutton, Charles Topping, the Fisher brothers. Every word these operators uttered in public was slavishly reported in the press and on the radio. The stock exchange guides were used to dealing with the blandishments of attractive female investors anxious to meet famous traders. A woman's magazine had recently reported that stockbrokers equaled movie stars in sex appeal. To avoid the risk of a sexy siren waylaying a trader, on this last day of the year, the guides had cleared the gallery well before William Crawford's gong ended trading. When 3 p.m. was announced, a 5-piece orchestra began to play at one end of the gallery. The guides opened burlap bags of confetti, ticker tape, paper hats, and noisemakers. From the Stock Exchange Luncheon Club on the 7th floor, waiters filed out of the kitchen carrying silver tureens. The club was one of the most exclusive in New York. Few non-members had ever been inside the spacious room to admire its collection of early American prints, let alone to dine off one of the most sumptuous menus in the city. An outsider needed 8 favorable votes to be admitted. 2 blackballs meant exclusion. The credit limit was $100, even for members like Percy Rockefeller and Jack Morgan, who were individually worth millions. In solemn procession, the waiters marched into the gallery with tureens of clam juice cocktail that for the past 20 years had been a favorite beverage among brokers. The cocktail's fame had spread across America. This afternoon it would serve as the official aperitif at the Stock Exchange's traditional New Year's Eve party. The members, their staff, wives, and mistresses had all been invited. Nevertheless, there would be some notable absentees. The elder John D. Rockefeller, who still owned a seat on the exchange, had not visited the building for years. Jack Morgan, son of the legendary J.P., was a member, but had never entered the exchange to do business, let alone sip clam juice with clerks in a drab public gallery. Many of the senior members, veterans who had traded for 50 years and who still talked mistily of the great stock market panic of 1893, had slipped away before the end of trading to reminisce in one of the speakeasies tucked away in side streets around the exchange. Several of the affluent younger brokers decided to miss the party because there were more promising celebrations to attend uptown. Mindful of their mystique and social position, they knew it would be easy for them to pick up glamorous flappers at one of those parties. Some of the biggest market manipulators would be absent because they were not members of the exchange, preferring to mastermind their financial operations from outside. They were, therefore, not eligible to be invited to what was in essence a glorified office party. Like all such gatherings, shop talk predominated. Almost everybody had a story to tell of a spectacular killing. An actor had made $40,000 from Vanadium Steel, Schulte Cigar Stores, Public Utilities of New Jersey, and Wright Aero. A waiter at the exchange's luncheon club had resigned, $90,000 better off, as a result of tips passed on by his customers. He had successfully plunged into the market with $5,000 saved from 10 and 25 cent tips. A stenographer was $15,000 richer through selling General Motors stock she had only had for 2 days. The girl promptly bought a fur coat and reinvested the balance in Anaconda Copper, a stock widely tipped to rise spectacularly in early 1929. Everybody in the gallery knew what a tip could do. Only last March, John J. Raskob, a director of General Motors, had uttered a few sentences of optimism about the automobile industry, and his company's stock had driven upward 12 points. Raskob was a man to watch. So was Arthur Cutton. 6 months earlier, Cutton had moved his operations from Chicago to Wall Street. He was dealing in 200,000 shares a day, Armor and Company, Radio, Montana Power, United States Cast Iron Pipe. His takings so far were put at $100 million. It was this sort of talk that made an otherwise dull party hum. An impromptu cabaret spot by a group of page boys caught the mood, their piping voices summing up a national attitude. Oh, hush thee, my baby, granny's bought some more shares. Daddy's gone to play with the bulls and the bears. Mother's buying on tips and she simply can't lose, and baby shall have some expensive new shoes. In a corner of the gallery, a group of young traders stiffened their clam cocktails with shots of potent homemade whiskey and listened eagerly to the words of Michael J. Meehan. Just 15 years before, Meehan was selling theater tickets at 71 Broadway and making about $5,000 a year. Now he was possibly the best-known broker in America and president of his own firm, with 8 stock exchange seats, the largest number ever held by a commission house. In 1920, when he had bought his first seat, he had 2 employees. Now he had some 400, with an annual payroll of around $600,000. When Meehan had become a broker, he had made only $18 profit his first month. He fell back to selling theater tickets to augment his income. 2 years later, he had saved enough to lay out the $90,000 needed to buy his first seat on the exchange. His latest had cost him close to $500,000. He hadn't blinked when he'd written the check. Money, Meehan was fond of telling newspaper men, was there for the spending and making. Short, with the first hint of a potbelly, he wore steel-rimmed spectacles that made him look older than his 38 years. He worked hard to maintain his casual, offbeat image. He loved it when the media called him one of the boys, when they reported he still wore soft shirts and did not care a whoop whether his tie is the latest thing from London or whether it is knotted at just the proper point under his Adam's apple. That sort of publicity helped to divert interest from his tough, ruthless style of operating, typified by the way he had speculated in and made a fortune from one of the most glamorous of all new stocks, RCA. Mike Meehan was the exchange's specialist in radio. Most buy-or-sell orders of the stock had to be made through him or members of his firm at Post 12. During 1928, he had helped engineer radio's meteoric rise and made for himself an estimated $25 million. Now he was preparing for a fresh foray on the conservative Anaconda copper stock. In great secrecy, Meehan was planning to organize a pool with funds from such financial giants as Percy Rockefeller, the Fisher brothers, and John J. Raskob. He expected he would have no difficulty in finding other participants whose money would swell that available to over $30 million. Then they would act. There were still weeks of careful groundwork to be laid before the first moves in the market would be made. But now Meehan was able to relax, sip a drink, and be glad that this New Year's Eve the orchestra had not singled him out by playing an Irish melody. He hated all that ethnic nonsense. Down on the stock exchange floor there was now a milling crowd of men and women, some of them dancing, many of them fortified from hip flasks, the fashionable answer to Prohibition, now in its 8th year. 2 men moved ostentatiously and ceremoniously among the guests. Each was aware of his own importance. The elder was Edward Henry Harriman Simmons, president of the New York Stock Exchange these past 5 years. The spiteful said that Simmons would really have preferred canonization, election to the papacy, or the role of Lord Mayor of London, that he had accepted only as a poor alternative the most important electoral office in the financial world. His few friends said that he was born for his exalted and unsalaried post. For them, he epitomized the Puritanism of those 24 brokers who in May 1792 gathered under a buttonwood tree and drew up a written agreement to deal only with each other on a common commission basis, so forming the exchange Simmons now presided over. His few public pronouncements on the market were predictable and ponderous. The press preferred to quote his companion. Richard Whitney was vice president of the exchange and probably the most unpopular man among the rank-and-file members ever to hold that office. They resented the way he calculatingly charmed reporters while treating his colleagues in cavalier fashion. With representatives of the media, he talked shamelessly of his fine athletic record at Harvard and his impressive business and social contacts. In the exchange, he was invariably imperious, rude, or icily disdainful to virtually everyone. Most members of the exchange found Whitney an insufferable snob. Money and the right connections had swept him to office. His brother George was a Morgan partner, and Richard himself was known as the Morgan Broker. When the gods of 23 Wall, the address of the headquarters of the House of Morgan and the only identification on its entrance door, had business to transact on the exchange that they themselves so fastidiously avoided, they assumed the bodily form of the broad-shouldered, bull-necked Whitney. His own firm, Richard Whitney & Company, was a bond house, with no interest in that stormy side of the market where stocks are traded. Everything about him, his suits, his cars, his homes, his associates, suggested he was a pillar of America's financial establishment. Yet behind Whitney's carefully burnished image of huntsman, yachtsman, and patrician was another, altogether less successful man. For years he had been borrowing heavily from his brother George and a broker friend to finance recklessly speculative personal investments in the stock of, among others, a fertilizer business in Florida and an Applejack distillery in New Jersey. In the year just ending, he had borrowed $590,000, gambled, and lost. No one dared protest at his actions. Whitney's Morgan connections were too powerful to upset. For many years, the exchange had been dominated by the great banking and investment house which was its neighbor and the most powerful nexus of capitalism in the world. The House of Morgan annually gave out millions of dollars in gifts to favored clients, often to the benefit of exchange governors. The cynics of Wall Street said that whenever a string was pulled across the street at Morgan's, the exchange jumped. Whitney was confident that the overpowering influence of J.P. Morgan & Company would help him achieve his ultimate ambition, to take the place of the man he now walked with through the throng of partygoers. What none of them could know was that the splendidly handsome Whitney, the obvious heir apparent for the position of president of the stock exchange, was in fact, with every day that passed, becoming ever more deeply and dangerously in debt. The departure of Simmons and Whitney marked the formal end of the celebrations. By early evening, there were only a few stragglers left. Some of them were planning a surreptitious visit to the House of Morgan, not J.P.'s, but Helen's. Miss Morgan ran the most popular speakeasy in Midtown Manhattan, if not in the entire Prohibition dry city of 32,000 similar establishments. Police Commissioner Grover Whalen's men had just done a count and admitted that figure was probably low. Speakeasies operated in the basements of fashionable Fifth Avenue mansions, in Park Avenue penthouses, in Greenwich Village cellars, in two-family dwellings in the Bronx, in the back of Bay Ridge hardware stores, even in Wall Street office buildings. They flourished behind facades of soft drink parlors, restaurants, and tea rooms. There was one on the east side with an exterior that looked like a synagogue. None was as well appointed as the House of Morgan, with its blues-in-the-night music, snazzy decor, and bootleg liquor with the kick of a mule. Helen's was also the place where a broker could pick up some of the youngest and most delectable whores in town. Both houses of Morgan, Jack's and Helen's, flourished in part because it was the heyday of easy money. Both required introduction before entry. But once inside, the specialist facilities offered by each house were at the disposal of their privileged clientele. In the offices of the New York Times, reporters prepared end-of-year stories. The main foreign news concerned the vigil Londoners were keeping outside Buckingham Palace, where King George was gravely ill. Almost equal space was given to an account of Berliners preparing to hail 1929 with old-time joy, when they would consume some 9 million holeless donuts, drink 500,000 gallons of beer, and set off tens of millions of fireworks. On the home front, the impending inauguration at noon on January 1st of Franklin D. Roosevelt as governor of New York, taking over from the much-loved Al Smith, would be front-page news. But it would be Wall Street that would again dominate next day's paper. Working steadily, financial editor Alexander Dana Noyes laid out his pages, editing copy brought to his desk. One story noted that violent advances in the last hour by a handful of market leaders featured yesterday's extremely large operations on the stock exchange. The volume of trading was the heaviest since December 10th. This, the paper would report, came as a surprise to Wall Street, where the last day of the year is often, by tradition, given over to a few cash sales. Another page recorded the day's sales at 4,887,700 shares, bringing the total for 1928 to 920,550,032 stocks traded. A new record. The money market had also closed on a brisk, hopeful note. The foreign markets, especially London and Berlin, had made modest gains. Noyes was a veteran financial editor, respected and even feared in Wall Street. Twice during 1928, in the market breaks of June and December, he had predicted that the bull market was over. Though proven wrong, he had doggedly clung to his belief that it would only be a matter of time before the boom ended. In his view, there was no way the present spiraling trend could continue. He had told his reporters, "Something has to give. It's like an earthquake. The further you are from the last one, the closer you are to the next." Noyes's instincts told him not only that a stock market crash was coming, but that when it came, it would flatten Wall Street. That would be the day the bubble burst. Superintendent William Crawford would not leave the exchange until the gallery and floor were completely clear of revelers. Then, his gavel safely locked away in his office, he put on his topcoat, said Happy New Year to a watchman, and walked out of the building. Crawford found himself in an almost deserted Wall Street. It was now dark, and the money, his generic term for brokers, bankers, and financial men of all kinds, had departed, leaving the area to a few clerks working late on their ledgers. It was the time of day Crawford found most witching. There were few people abroad to detract from the awesome power he sensed around him. From where he stood, looking directly east past the six short blocks to the river, even in the gloom Crawford knew that Wall Street was not quite straight. It had a slight kink in it. Diagonally across the street from Crawford was the old sub-treasury building. For the past 9 years it had housed minor government offices, including some of the 200 federal agents responsible for enforcing prohibition in New York. Next door was the U.S. Assay Office. On this New Year's Eve, the depository held more gold than anywhere else on earth. Daily, a trickle of refiners, pawnbrokers, and dentists added to that hoard by turning in gold. Occasionally, assay officials received a reformed burglar, anxious to make amends by cashing in his loot. Nobody asked any questions or called the FBI. The stolen gold was merely bought at market value. Farther east, on the north side of the street, beside the assay office, stood the Bank of Manhattan Company building, the second highest skyscraper in New York, its pinnacle now lost against the darkened sky. Alongside, on the corner of William Street, stood the more modest Bank of America. Running down toward the river were the offices of the other 89 major banks in the district, the 25 trust companies, and the fiscal offices of 130 railroads. Sandwiched in between were 57 life insurance companies, 209 fire and marine insurance companies, and over 100 other types of insurance companies. In the side streets, with their so English names, Nassau, Pearl, Water, Front, and South, were also the offices of 15 safe deposit companies, 20 cable and telegraph companies, 50 coal and iron companies, and hundreds of powerful industrial corporations. Close by were the other exchanges, the Curb Exchange, the Produce Exchange, the Cotton Exchange, the Metals Exchange, the Sugar Exchange, the Maritime Exchange. None was so powerful, so ornate as the Stock Exchange, yet each had its part to play in maintaining Crawford's long-held belief that he worked in the financial capital of the world. Visible proof that this was still so was there for the superintendent to see. The lights at 23 Wall were ablaze. Limousines were parked from that famous entrance to the House of Morgan, past the Equitable Company at number 35, the home of some of the largest law firms in America, beyond the U.S. Trust Company, whose chairman, John Stewart, had died in office, aged 104. The cars were parked the length of the block, down to the Atlantic Building. Beyond, on the south side of Wall, its frontage filling a whole block, was the massive edifice of the National City Bank, the wealthiest in the country with resources in excess of $2 billion. Bought by the government in 1862 as a site for a customs house at a cost of $11 million, it had been acquired by National City in 1899 for over three times that amount, an indication of how property, even in those days, had been at a premium in Wall Street. The bank was one of the most beautiful buildings in the street, with its colonnade of pillars, each carved from a single piece of stone and weighing 25 tons. Next door stood the Brown Brothers building, sometimes known as Little England Beyond the Sea, because the conservative international bankers who owned it had a weakness for Englishman, Yale, and the Atlantic Monthly. Still farther down Wall, between Pearl and Water Streets, was the Orient Building, next to the home of Steinwender, Stoffregen and Company, coffee importers. Those who worked there quickly became permeated with the odor from roasted sample lots. A similar problem faced those at number 90, Coco, and 109, home of the American Molasses Company. Tonight, these buildings appeared merely as dark shapes from where Crawford stood. He turned and began to walk briskly west along Wall Street toward Broadway. His footsteps echoed on sidewalks that were part of the most valuable real estate in the world. A square foot fetched $700. Crawford passed the site for the new Irving Trust Building, which would rise between New Street and Broadway this coming year. Since 1650, only three other buildings had ever been erected on the site. When completed, the Irving skyscraper would dwarf the dingy, decrepit building opposite, housing the First National Bank. Ahead lay Broadway, where at number 26, John D. Rockefeller maintained an office he now never visited. Nearby was the historic graveyard of Trinity Church, whose dark Gothic spire rose majestically in the concrete canyons of Wall and Broadway. The church, like many others in the city, had grown rich from the market. Investment had allowed it to become a large Manhattan landowner, with properties whose book value stood at over $15 million, bringing in annual rentals of $1 million. Not for the first time did it occur to William Crawford that Wall Street was the perfect example of how religion and big business could be compatible. Over 3,000 miles away, in the late afternoon sun of Northern California, in a time zone 3 hours earlier than New York, A cloud of dust whirled past a far more simply built church than the gloomy splendor of Trinity. It was one of the whitewashed, bleached adobe structures Catholic missionaries had erected last century along the Pacific coast. A glowing red light and familiar wailing came from within the moving cloud. Ahead, in the small town, children were running excitedly toward the approaching noise. In the heart of the traveling dust storm, Joe Garcia changed gear. The grimed Rolls-Royce, a 1926 model, reduced speed and purred down the town's main street. The fire alarm light, welded under the car's classically styled hood, continued to glow, the siren to wail. This regulation-type equipment, purchased from the San Francisco Fire Department 6 weeks before, still troubled chauffeur Garcia. Such a desecration, he felt, was enough to make Misters Rolls and Royce wish the wheel had never happened. No one except his passenger, Garcia contended, would have ruined the styling of the car simply to facilitate his business interests. But the chauffeur knew that his employer had no feel for the Rolls tradition. He didn't even know where the gas went in. He only had one interest, his work. With the approval of the California State Legislature, the handmade Rolls-Royce had been classified a fire truck, and Garcia's employer, banker Amadeo Peter Giannini, designated an honorary fire marshal. The idea was suggested by the impatient Giannini as the easiest way to overcome a state law restricting all but police and fire department vehicles to 35 miles an hour. It was only proper that the transportation used by a fire marshal carried at least a siren and light. When Garcia had suggested the light may be kept inside the car, the banker had shaken his massive Roman emperor's head and insisted that it be mounted on the hood. During the past weeks, the towns of Northern California had witnessed the extraordinary sight of the Rolls racing down their streets as if it was on its way to a three-alarm call. Giannini felt he needed to travel at a speed of 80 miles an hour because it was the only way he could keep pace with his expanding financial empire. Even on the road, he had no time to relax. As the Rolls sped effortlessly over the dusty, bumpy dirt tracks linking one settlement to another, its owner pored over paperwork, a penalty he cheerfully paid for being one of the most important bankers in America. On the last day of the year, they had been on the road since dawn, traveling from one bank to another. Lunch had been hurried because Giannini had an important appointment to keep in a small town north of San Francisco. When they reached it, on time, the banker learned the meeting had been canceled. He had given vent to his anger with a few well-chosen expletives. Fully aroused, the multimillionaire could out-curse a longshoreman. Only Garcia would have dared intrude on Giannini's brooding silence as they sped back toward the city. The chauffeur reminded his employer that Giannini was to preside over the family's traditional New Year's Eve dinner that night. "Boss, you better get a shave, otherwise Mrs. A.P.'s going to be mad at me." Giannini grinned, his anger gone. The thought of Clorinda mad at anyone, let alone the devoted Garcia, was impossible for him to contemplate. His wife, the same age as himself, 58, had during all their marriage shown a forbearance and tolerance he marveled over. Clorinda had never raised her voice or complained. She had always loyally supported him in every risk he took. She was, he confided to his friends, the perfect Italian wife. The Rolls stopped outside the town barber shop. Garcia hoped it was empty, the barber ready. Giannini had not shaved himself for 20 years, regarding it as non-productive and time-consuming. He had told Garcia, "In the time I would take to shave, I could read a company report and make a decision that could maybe bring in $1 million, maybe more." Impressed, the chauffeur had set up a unique tonsorial network. During the past year, as Giannini expanded his banking enterprises throughout California, in between entrenching his position in Wall Street, Garcia briefed every barber he came across that whenever he pulled up in a Rolls, the barber must be prepared instantly to attend his master. The chauffeur promised a quarter tip on top of the 10-cent charge for the shave. Escorting his master into the shop, Garcia was relieved to see it was empty. There was no risk of anybody pestering the banker for advice about the stock market, something that frequently happened nowadays as Giannini became one of the most quoted figures on the state of the American economy. His shaggy eyebrows, bristling mustache, and bruiser's nose stared out of hundreds of newspapers. The photographs accompanying stories about his predilections and financial moves. The fiercely proud Garcia felt that no newspaper photo conveyed the most striking of all Giannini's features, his eyes. They could see through a person, into his heart and mind, and they were the mirror of AP's own soul. Seated in the tilted barber's chair, Giannini's eyes were now closed, his face smothered by hot towels. Garcia watched the barber carefully wet a razor. The chauffeur had an abiding fear that someday a crank would harm the man he loved with that special affection only one Italian man has for another. Distanced by money and power, the two men were nevertheless closely linked by their similar backgrounds. They shared the same pride in family, church, and America. To protect Giannini, the chauffeur carried a Colt 38 in an armpit holster. Every weekend at the San Francisco Police Armory, Garcia practiced shooting. He was skilled enough to kill a man at 50 feet. He hoped he would never have to shoot. Yet he knew that if it came to a choice between AP and anybody, then I wouldn't hesitate to kill. Giannini had always commanded such loyalty. Perhaps it stemmed from that day in October 1904, when, barely 34 years old, Giannini had quit the produce business in order to found the first People's Bank in America. The odds were stacked against him. He had no real banking experience, no connections in high places. San Francisco had a history of big banks for big people. In spite of being the financial capital of the West, its banks really only catered for the wealthy, upstate ranchers and the like, and mines, lumber mills, and city developments. A bank would loan $1 million to buy a ranch or extend a railroad as quickly as it would refuse a man $50 to improve his home. The poor were driven to the loan sharks, who charged them exorbitant interest. Giannini decided to change that, opening the Bank of Italy for the masses. 3,000 shares of stock were issued. No stockholder, including Giannini, held more than 100 shares. Over half the shares were in the hands of 1,620 stockholders. Among them were a grocer, a fish dealer, a teamster, and a druggist. Many held no more than 2 or 3 shares. Every day, Giannini tramped the Italian district of North Beach, where he had grown up, touting for business. Within 18 months, he had persuaded a stream of small investors to put their money in the Bank of Italy, where it earned 3.5% interest, rather than to leave it in a tin on a shelf in the back parlor. The other city bankers, aristocrats raised and nurtured in the timeless traditions of the Rothschilds of London and Lazare Frere of Paris, looked with contempt at Giannini scrabbling for business. To some, it was no better than they expected of an Italian who had once sold vegetables and was now treating the serious business of banking as if it were the same as peddling grapefruit. They talked disparagingly of the Dago banker, a man never to be admitted to that intimate circle dominated by the American National Bank and the men of Wells Fargo. Then, at 5:13 a.m. on April 18, 1906, came the Great Leveler. Earthquake devastated San Francisco, swiftly followed by a raging inferno. The city badly needed a calming gesture. Giannini provided it. While other bankers, their money sealed in vaults inside buildings too dangerous to enter or buried beneath tons of rubble, were reduced to sending reassuring telegrams to the stock exchanges in New York, London, Paris, and Berlin, Giannini executed a financial coup. He had rescued $80,000 in cash from his bank at the height of the fire. It was all he had to cover deposits of $846,000. If there was a run, if depositors decided to withdraw their savings in full, the Bank of Italy would face a crisis from which it could probably never recover. Giannini decided on a calculated gamble. He would use the $80,000, hidden in his living room fireplace, for loans to help people to restart businesses and rebuild their homes. The bank would lend at a fair interest, and by doing so, Giannini hoped also to attract enough new depositors to balance the loans. The risks were huge. The loans would have to be carefully parceled out. He could not be certain he would be repaid. He had no guarantee he could attract new depositors. But the rewards, if the plan worked, would be substantial. They were, and the Bank of Italy prospered. A year later, during the financial panic of 1907, which J.P. Morgan finally quelled, Giannini laid in so much gold that he had to hire storage space. His was the only bank in California able to meet all the demands of its customers. Thousands more new depositors flocked to the Bank of Italy. The dream that had sustained Giannini for years began to come closer. He was sure the day could not be far off before branch banking became a reality, when it would be possible to find Bank of Italy branches in every state and eventually in every city and most towns. World War I temporarily ended that hope. But by 1919 it had returned, stronger than before, driving Giannini to break into the New York banking world. Characteristically, he went first to the East Side, with its modest family homes and small shops. For the moment, he ignored Wall Street, and, as they had done in San Francisco 15 years earlier, the great banking houses of New York looked down their noses at this upstart. The betting in the smoking and club rooms was that the IT would not last a year. Giannini bought two banks, the East River and the Bowery National. He amalgamated them and founded the Bank Italy Corporation as a holding company. 10 years later, its assets totaled $250 million, and its stockholders numbered 75,000. Mastering corporate procedure, Giannini claimed he had more corporate balls whirling in the air than a juggler at a county fair, he incorporated and consolidated in a series of virtuoso performances that brought bank after bank into his fold. In 1927, he engineered the greatest merger in U.S. banking history when, in one fell swoop, the 174-branch Liberty Bank of America and the substantial Italian-American of San Francisco were absorbed by the Bank of Italy. It put Giannini on a par with the biggest banks in New York. It put Wall Street on notice. The New York Times issued its seal of approval on October 30, 1927. Son of immigrant interests bankers. Success of A.P. Giannini, who founded Bank of Italy, an international marvel. His methods all his own. Ignoring precedents, San Francisco man has developed a $500 million institution. From that day on, the press never left him alone. They and millions of their readers watched open-mouthed as Giannini executed a series of complex and interwoven deals which allowed him to invest $162.5 million in foreign stocks and bonds, as a cushion against the time when depression could affect domestic conditions. Everybody thought that was Giannini's little joke, the Dago banker allowing his background to show. Everybody, said the pundits, knew that this was late 1927 and America was already firmly gripped in the beginnings of a boom. Giannini continued to invest abroad, choosing such gilt-edged stocks as those of the Bank of England, the Bank of Ireland, the Banque de France, the Reichsbank, and the Suez Canal. By January 1928, he owned 289 banks, including the relatively small but prestigious 116-year-old Bank of America. Lauded by the world's press, reporters traveled from all over Europe to interview him, and he was attracting more coverage than many of the stars of the Hollywood studios he had invested in, Giannini recognized that the enemy was at the door. He identified them correctly as Wall Street speculators, boosting his bank's shares beyond their true worth in order to make a killing for themselves. In one day, he saw Bank Italy stock soar 10 points, $10, on the San Francisco and New York stock exchanges. He fought back, mobilizing his considerable talent for publicity. In February 1928, he served historic warning on the public not to buy his stocks, as they were overvalued. The speculation continued. "The great bull of Wall Street was in the corral and everybody was trying to hitch a ride," was how Joe Garcia saw it. The chauffeur remembered how bitterly angry Giannini was as he prepared to depart on a planned business and vacation trip to Europe. That was in April 1928. 6 weeks later, on June 11th, a cablegram reached Giannini in Milan. It brought the first news of Blue Monday. Shares in Bank of Italy had fallen 160 points. Bank of America was down 120 points. Bank Italy Corporation had plunged 86 points, United Security 80 points. To Garcia, "The speculators had made their killing, packed their tents, and left AP bleeding to death." 6,000 miles away in Italy, Giannini gave the first orders to transfuse stock from one company to another. Then, as he was packing his bags to come home, he was struck down with polyneuritis. Hospitalized in Rome, he spent the next two painful months waging a relentless fight to recover his health and financial fortune. On September 5th, 1928, fit again but considerably thinner, his face lined and gaunt, he reached San Francisco. His first words to Garcia were, "Those bastards will never do this to us again." The chauffeur couldn't trust himself to speak. In silence, they drove to Giannini's office in midtown San Francisco. Hundreds of people overflowed the bank and onto the sidewalks to welcome him. Thousands of floral tributes turned the austere building into a gigantic florist's. It would be days before the sweet fragrance disappeared. Close to tears himself, Giannini had choked, "It's good to be back." Those were his last public words for a month. He moved from his modest family home in San Mateo to a room in the Mark Hopkins Hotel in the city. To Garcia, this was a sure sign something big was brewing. Even the prescient chauffeur could not have guessed how big. The financial world itself was stunned when, on October 11th, Giannini announced he was consolidating his multifaceted organization under one speculation-tight umbrella. It would be the greatest holding company in the world, inviolate, he hoped, from the attention of even the most rapacious of the Wall Street bears. Giannini named it Transamerica Corporation. It was capitalized at $217.5 million. A mere pittance just to get things started. Tucked away from the grubby speculators Giannini so despised, behind the shiny new Transamerica shield were Bank of Italy, Bank Italy Corporation, National Bank Italy Company, California Joint Stock Land Bank, Bank Italy Agricultural Credit Corporation, Bank Italy Mortgage Company, American Commercial Corporation, Pacific National Fire Insurance Company, and the Capital Company. From now on, only Transamerica stock would be dealt with on the open market. It was first listed on the San Francisco Exchange on November 15th and was an immediate success. The very next day, Giannini had the fire alarm light mounted on the Rolls-Royce, which was now outside the barber shop and attracting a growing crowd of children and adults. When Garcia and Giannini emerged, a man shouted, "What kind of a fire truck is this?" "A special kind. It puts out speculative fires." Grinning hugely at his jest, Amadeo Peter Giannini climbed into the back and instantly returned to his paperwork. He was glad to see that an East Coast newspaper had given prominence to the news that he had divested himself of some $1.5 million, the bulk of his personal fortune, in favor of an agricultural research program at the University of California. The paper had approvingly reported, "He retains only that amount necessary comfortably to maintain and educate his family. He has not, and never had, an ambition to make or save money for himself, but has devoted his time toward the building up of a great bank system, which his employees eventually will own." Giannini was further pleased with a syndicated Scripps Howard report calling him the J.P. Morgan of the Pacific. The reporter was the first to note that Transamerica included only a part of the total Giannini empire. Outside the paling was the Bank of America with its 30 branches in New York, the 73 branches of the United Securities Bank, the 28 branches of the Merchants National in Los Angeles, and the 290 branch banks he controlled in California. All were deemed to be strong enough to withstand any speculative pressures. The writer lauded Giannini as the father of the branch bank idea. What nobody knew in these closing hours of 1928 was just how far Giannini was willing to go to ensure his idea grew to maturity. He leaned forward and shouted at Garcia, "Morgan and the Fed are in for a surprise or two next year."
"Yes, boss."
Garcia knew who Morgan was.
"That snotty bunch in Wall Street who didn't like Catholics or Jews."
But the reference to the Fed puzzled him. He could not imagine how his employer was going to surprise the FBI. The chauffeur was about to ask, but Giannini was once more immersed in paperwork. It never occurred to Joe Garcia that his passenger was referring to the Federal Reserve Board, or that he had just heard a declaration of war. A different declaration, but equally portentous, was made in New York that evening by John Jacob Raskob, a 49-year-old millionaire who had boosted his already huge fortune by successfully speculating in Giannini stock. For months, the cherubic-faced Raskob, who was born in the slums of New York's Hell's Kitchen and went on to help develop General Motors, had kept the staggering plan to himself. Tonight, Raskob was ready to unveil his dream to the man he had chosen to make it possible. William Lamb had a considerable reputation as one of the architects changing the skyline of Midtown Manhattan. Every day, one tall building followed another into the air, many of them rising from Lamb's blueprints. He had not been surprised to be summoned to Raskob's palatial suite at the Carlton House, but once inside he felt he had walked into a library. Every available wall was lined with books. They overflowed from tables onto the floor. The architect's trained eye noted the absence of clocks. The financier had an aversion to timepieces of any kind. The brightly colored shirt Raskob wore was a further pointer that here was one more of that eccentric new breed of millionaires who manipulated in Wall Street with consummate ease. Lamb had grown rich catering to their whims. He'd given Jesse Livermore a new office, refurbished William Crapo Durant's apartment, advised a dozen other big market men on their homes or office towers. He had found it profitable to study his clients. Consequently, Lamb already knew a great deal more about the secretive Raskob than the short and burly millionaire would have cared to reveal.
The architect knew that Raskob abhorred smoking, though his father was a noted cigar maker in Alsace, that the financier hated to drive, in spite of having made his initial fortune from automobiles. Raskob kept two Cadillacs and a chauffeur, but insisted on walking everywhere in New York. His wife refused to live in the city, preferring to remain in Wilmington, Delaware, with their 11 children. There, Raskob owned a palatial manor house, Archmere, on the Delaware River. In summer, the family moved to their rustic retreat, Pioneer Point, Maryland, where they grew flax and tended their splendid stable of horses. The only blight on this idyllic lifestyle came in the summer of 28, when the Raskob's second son, William, died in an auto accident. None of this knowledge had prepared Lamb for what Raskob wanted. The two men walked to the Waldorf Astoria Hotel on the corner of Fifth Avenue and 33rd Street.
"It's coming down," said Raskob casually. "You're going to see to that, just as you're going to put in its place the tallest building on earth."
Too stunned to reply, Lamb followed the financier into the 450-room red brick and sandstone structure, patterned after the German Renaissance style and built at a cost of $5 million in 1893. During the subsequent 35 years, the hotel had firmly established itself as a magnet for New York society. Tonight, extravagant costume balls and bacchanalian feasts were scheduled for the gold and burgundy-draped restaurants and ballrooms. Yet, in spite of all its outward splendor, the hotel was an expensive anachronism. Taxes and escalating operating costs ate away the profits. Weeks before, having failed to have former New York Governor Alfred E. Smith elected President of the United States, Herbert Hoover had trounced Smith in the election, Raskob, back to wheeler dealing in Wall Street, had heard a whisper that the hotel was up for sale. Working from the 23rd floor offices he shared with Pierre DuPont at 230 Park Avenue, Raskob had sounded out trusted friends, among them James J. Reardon, president of the New York County Trust Company. Their inquiries confirmed that the hotel could be bought cheaply. Now, pausing in the cavernous lobby with its potted palms and uniformed flunkies, Raskob repeated he would shortly buy the hotel, raise it to the ground, and that in its place Lamb would design and supervise the erection of the ninth wonder of the world. It would be a permanent monument to the American way of life that allowed a poor boy to make his fortune in Wall Street. John J. Raskob already had a name for the superstructure. He would call it the Empire State Building. Claire Giannini could relax. Her contribution to the New Year's Eve family dinner had not provoked criticism. Her father merely glanced at the gleaming new silverware that Claire had purchased to replace the worn, bone-handled flatware used since she was a child. Tonight, Giannini had not unbuttoned his collar or removed his jacket before sitting down to the meal. His daughter was pleased at these small signs of propriety in her father. She dearly loved him, but silently despaired whether he would ever develop the sartorial elegance of the men in those fashionable houses back east. She had often wondered what they would think of the two-story Giannini family home in San Mateo, 17 miles from San Francisco. She still found it difficult to explain to even the most understanding of her wealthy friends that Papa isn't interested in worldly possessions. As long as she could remember, her father had firmly resisted any attempts to make him dress or live in the style of one of the world's most successful bankers. He had rejected any suggestions that he should have his suits tailored, even though nowadays he was regularly meeting such men of influence as the Pope, President-elect Hoover, and dictator Benito Mussolini. The last time she had raised the question, on the eve of their visit to Rome, he had angrily shaken his head and reminded Claire that he had not given her a fine education to worry about such trivial matters. For years she had known that
Papa was grooming me to take over some of his responsibilities. While other teenagers concerned themselves with clothes, Claire studied balance sheets. She now knew more about corporate matters than many of the lawyers who advised her father. She could spot the faults in even the most polished prospectus, and had an unerring instinct for an overinflated budget. She took quiet pride in being called a chip off the old block. Claire knew that her aggressiveness and command of boardroom strategy frightened off many men. Other potential suitors were shown the door because her father suspected they were fortune hunters. Her mother had told her that when the right man comes along, you will have our blessing. Having failed to persuade her father to improve his wardrobe, he still owned only 5 ready-made suits bought in a local department store, Claire had tried to titivate the family home. Most of the furniture was bought the year she was born, 1904. 24 years later, it showed increasing signs of wear and tear. But Giannini stubbornly insisted that nothing should be replaced without his sanction. Claire still vividly recalled the time she suggested that the dining room suite be replaced.
"I'm not made of money," her father had said.
"But you make so much."
"For others, Claire, for others."
Giannini had been trying for years to convince not only his family, but the whole world that he had no wish to be a millionaire or adopt the lifestyle of one. In 1924, he had announced that he would no longer draw a salary as president of the $115 million Bank Italy Corporation. He told a banking magazine, "I work without thinking of myself." Claire found it hard to accept the frugality her father preached. She still felt the need to protest his refusal to spend money on the family when the newspapers were reporting a new bequest to some school or university. After hearing her out, Giannini would invariably say,
"Look how unhappy money can make you. Be like me and have no interest in it for yourself, and you'll be a lot happier."
She had yet to find an answer to that argument. Nor could she now think of a suitable reply when her father finally commented on the new silver.
"Very nice," he pronounced, "but it's going to need regular polishing. Another job for you, Claire."
The meal was barely over when the family's privacy was interrupted. The wire services wanted Giannini's financial prediction for the coming year. He reminded reporters that in this era of unbounded prosperity, over 4,000 banks had failed during the past 6 years. It was a sign that something was wrong. If things didn't improve, there could be serious trouble ahead. It was meaty copy for turn-of-the-year stories from a banker who knew the value of publicity, even though it would bring him growing resentment from within the walls of the single most powerful financial house in the world, one that preferred to conduct its affairs in the closest secrecy. Only in the direst emergency would any public utterance be considered by the House of Morgan. Engines idling, the line of limousines stood guard along Wall Street, their liveried chauffeurs sensing that the hallowed ritual inside the squat, fortress-like building was coming to an end. By tradition, the first car was parked immediately outside the doors of 23. It belonged to John Pierpont Morgan, Jr., Jack, to members of the British royal family and a few other intimates, Mr. Morgan the Younger, to bankers around the world, Sir, to almost all his partners and staff. The second car in the line belonged to Thomas Lamont, senior partner and acknowledged deputy to Jack Morgan. Lamont was the firm's diplomat. His charm had won over financiers in Peking, brokers in Berlin, and corporate presidents in all those many countries that had been Morganized, a term that brought pain to the well-bred faces in the House of Morgan. The other cars, uniformly black apart from discreet chrome trim, belonged to the other partners, able financiers like Parker Gilbert and George Whitney, the elder brother of the exchange vice president.
Late though the hour was, they waited at their desks in an otherwise deserted building. The clerks and stenographers had long gone. The heavy outer doors of 23 and its walls bore no identification, offered no clue that from here, from the time it was built in 1914, Morgan's had been quietly financing governments and the business interests of the world. Tonight, as he did every New Year's Eve, Jack Morgan was calculating the accrued profits from the past 12 months. All day, from Europe, from Japan, from Australia, South Africa, from anywhere and anybody that the house had financed this past year, had come details of the interest and other payments due for such help. By custom, Jack Morgan would retain 50% of the net profits. The other half would be divided among his partners. The autocratic articles of partnership had been established by the most celebrated of the Morgans, Pierpont, Jack's father. Any dispute between the partners must be settled by the senior Morgan in the firm. His decision shall be final. The senior Morgan could compel any other partner to resign by dissolving his partnership. There was no redress or appeal. No capital contribution was asked of new partners. The philosophy of old-fashioned hierarchical private banking was laid down by an even earlier Morgan, Junius Spencer Morgan, and refined by Pierpont to a total reliance on economic trust enforced by social status. A Jew would never be invited to become a partner. No statement of the firm's financial condition would ever be issued to depositors. The house would never lend money to anyone who could merely provide sufficient collateral. It would only do business with those with whom it chose to do business. The same guiding principles applied to the house's acceptance of depositors. They must be clients before being allowed to place their money with the firm. To become a client required an introduction from another client, a person, in Jack's view, who was a good straight fellow. Seated at his roll-top desk, in the same ante-room by the front entrance where all the senior partners sat at identical individual roll-top desks, each with a gleaming brass spittoon by its side, Jack Morgan epitomized all that he himself sincerely believed was good and straight. He had aged gracefully. Now, at 62, he had an avuncular twinkle, a snow-white mustache, and startling black eyebrows. He dressed like his friend, England's Prince of Wales, somberly for the office, tweedily for the country estate he kept at Glen Cove on Long Island, stylishly for the mansion he maintained at 231 Madison Avenue. There was another townhouse in London, and a shooting lodge in Scotland to which Morgan invited the royal family from time to time for a spot of grouse shooting. Since April 1, 1913, the day his father died, Jack had run the firm. His first innovation was to introduce the 19 other partners to afternoon tea, English style. From then on, bone china, cups and saucers for tea, and plates of cucumber sandwiches and scones would be served to the partners in their private offices on the second floor. The ritual enhanced the impression that the House of Morgan was the most exclusive and influential club in the American financial world. Afternoon tea, blended with the wood-burning fireplaces, the sofas and easy chairs, creating the feeling that big business was the province of gentlemen. When death created a vacancy, Jack Morgan chose a new partner with care. Born to the purple, the unkind said that when he died Jack would render separate accounts to Caesar and to God, he was determined that all his partners would fit his concepts of physical and mental perfection. Physically, they tended to be tall, slim, handsome, fair, with copious heads of hair that turned impressively white. 20 years earlier, a Wall Street wag had coined the adage that, when the angels of God took unto themselves wives among the daughters of men, the result was Morgan Partners. This still held true in 1928. The Morgan partners, like thoroughbred dogs or horses, shared not only physical kinship, but a similar mental outlook which was a carefully controlled mix of Puritanism, class consciousness, and the solemn self-righteousness of late 19th century American Protestantism. No partner or employee could work for the firm if he was divorced. Sins of the flesh, if discovered, meant dismissal. Jack Morgan's favorite maxim was, "Do your work, be honest, keep your word, help when you can, be fair, be a good straight fellow." That dogma had carried him through a number of tribulations. There was that dreadful day in 1915 when Jack had encountered a would-be assassin at the Glen Cove estate. The man was armed with two primed revolvers and a stick of dynamite. Jack had not hesitated to tackle and overpower him. The resultant publicity had been more painful to face than the potential killer. There was that even worse moment when, on September 16, 1920, a bomb had exploded outside the firm. Jack had been on vacation in England. His eldest son, Julius, had been one of the five partners in the building. All escaped unhurt except Julius, who suffered a minor cut. But the ensuing publicity lasted for weeks. Only the iron control his own father had taught him enabled Jack Morgan to cope with the excesses of the press. The death of Pierpont Morgan grieved Jack greatly, though it would have been unthinkable for him to show public sorrow. Morgan the elder was a capitalist in the accepted mold, often ruthlessly energetic in his dealings. His son preferred a low-key role as organizer and executive, willing to deputize, content to retain overall policy control while leaving the daily operations to his partners. Yet sadness continued to blight his private life. In 1924, his mother died. A year later, his wife, Jessie, succumbed from sleeping sickness. Not even Julius really suspected how deep the pain penetrated his father's mind. By the time Jack Morgan buried Jessie, he had developed such self-control that nothing could shake it. He believed this was expected of a gentleman. In the 15 years he had led the firm, it had lost some of its temporal power in domestic affairs. The Federal Reserve Act of 1913 had heralded the end of Morgan & Company's de facto status as America's central bank. Since 1920, the emergence of gigantic corporations, able to finance their own growth from retained earnings, had eroded the Morgan purse-strong power over U.S. business. Even so, the Morgan style, with Jack at the helm, had been evident with the acquisition, jointly with the DuPonts, of control of General Motors in 1920. Abroad, Morganization was as potent as ever. In 1921, the House floated a substantial French government bond issue in the United States. Next, it backed and sold a Chinese bond issue. The Polish and Romanian governments were financed in 1922. The following year, Morgan kept the Cuban and Austrian governments solvent. In 1924, the firm loaned $100 million to the Bank of France and gave Japan a badly needed injection of capital. Between 1925 and 1928, the House loaned so much money, selling bonds, to so many countries that it inevitably brought unwelcome publicity. After Morgan had loaned Cuba money, the Havana regime threatened tax measures that would discriminate against Americans. Jack sent a man to Havana. The Cubans backed off. From Moscow came an orchestrated cry that Morgan capitalism was trying to run the world. In 1925, Thomas Lamont spent weeks in Rome with Mussolini and his finance minister, Count Volpi. Lamont returned home to recommend that the House undertake the sale of $100 million in bonds, plus another $50 million in loans. A syndicate was formed. Morgan taking $250,000 for managing it and lending its name to sell bonds. The syndicate, of which the firm was the linchpin, made a profit of $4.5 million. The stormy publicity that ensued genuinely puzzled Jack Morgan. To him, propping up Italy's fascist regime was good business. This past year had been mercifully free of headlines for a man who cringed every time he read his own name in the press. He devoutly hoped the coming year would be the same. On the filial front, he had promising expectations for the next 12 months. Julius was showing signs of real business acumen. He was now handily placed on the board of General Motors and United States Steel. His second boy, Henry Sturgis, was about to become a partner. Soon he, too, would be acquiring the directorships, which allowed the firm to keep its fingers firmly on the financial pulse of the world. Between them, the partners held directorships in a list of companies that filled 35 pages of closely typed foolscap. On this, the last day of 1928, Jack Morgan truly believed that the house was at its financial zenith. Yet, in spite of its continuing rock-solid base, there had been changes he and his partners had so far failed to appreciate. In the era of Pierpont Morgan, respect and admiration formed the basis of the American public's attitude toward the House of Morgan. But now, under Jack, there was a mounting feeling of awe and distrust that such vast wealth and power should be invested in so few hands. With Amadeo Peter Giannini winning increasing public praise for his rejection of amassing a private fortune, Jack Morgan, it was also widely reported, was himself now worth $500 million. Nobody really knew because, as in all things, Morgan kept his own financial affairs closely guarded from prying eyes. Nevertheless, on this New Year's Eve, he was about to increase his income by a sizable amount. His calculations complete, Jack Morgan rose to his feet, clutching a handful of envelopes. Moving from one roll-top desk to another, he handed an envelope to each of his partners. They murmured words of gratitude. Each envelope contained a bonus for the year's work, a check for not less than $1 million. Soon afterward, the limousines left Wall Street to the care of a patrolling policeman, shivering in the first snow flurries of 1929. Chapter 2. A View from Abroad. Across the Atlantic, the people of Great Britain began the new year with the feeling that, whatever it brought, it could only be an improvement on the one just ended. 1928 had been disappointing, with the newspapers constantly having to report that the hoped-for recovery in trade had not happened. Even so, for Clarence Charles Hattrie in London, 1929 had got off to a good start. There was so much happening to catch the attention of reporters that the mercurial financier doubted if even the most intuitive of the new breed of muckraking journalists in Fleet Street would inquire into what he was planning. The popular press, long his enemy, was too busy describing the latest police raids on the capital's nightclubs, where guests had been booked for drinking out of hours. That strange sin whose enormity is only exceeded by pederasty in Anglo-Saxon countries, one reporter declared. Male inversion was also under the fullest police persecution and newspaper scrutiny. Once homosexuality had been something scarcely comprehensible. It was King George V himself who had said in 1914 with genuine astonishment that, "I thought men like that shot themselves." Now, homosexuals, with their brittle humor and elegance, encouraged by Freud, Jung, Havelock Ellis, and Edward Carpenter, broke cover, congregated in certain pubs, and were driven from bar to bar across the city. Certain sections of the press found it boosted their circulation to be moral and sensational at the same time. The arts were still a favorite target. The Daily Mail, apostle of conservatism, regularly worked itself up into a fury over some book or play. Typically, on this first Thursday morning in January, the Daily Herald had burst the great new cumulus of rumors building up around Thomas Edward Lawrence, a man many regarded as Britain's quintessential hero of the desert. For months now, fresh from his escapades in Arabia, T.E. Lawrence had been in Karachi, translating Homer. But the Herald doubted if he was engaged in such a peaceful pastime. Calling Lawrence the arch-spy of the world, the socialist newspaper suggested that Lawrence was in Karachi to organize a right-wing revolution. Hatry, an astute judge of such matters, knew that the rekindled interest in Lawrence could last for weeks. He also knew too well how savage the press could be. The scar tissue, the result of 100 printed barbs, was still there from a decade before, concealed beneath Hatry's Savile Row suit, striped shirt, and carefully knotted tie. His specialty then, and now, was stock speculation on a massive scale, combined with a flair for promoting large company amalgamations, which Hatry liked to call part of his grand strategy for the rationalization of industry. Along the way, he had made and lost a number of fortunes. Hatry's first windfall came in 1912, when he had devised a scheme for emigrants traveling from Central Europe to the United States and Canada. Hundreds of thousands of Poles and Russians passed through the hands of Hatry's agents, whose job it was to insure them against the risk of rejection when they finally reached the New World. Hatry's own encounters with these poor wretches, many drawn from the lower strata of European civilization, affected him, he would insist, deeply. He felt they would be better directed to the underpopulated areas of the British Empire. The benefits for Britain would be obvious. The emigrants could be put to work developing the unlimited potential wealth of the empire, thus ensuring Britain's continuing preeminent role in the world. As yet, Hatry had not made public this vision. From 1919, when he formed British Glass Industries, he had fathered a number of industrial mergers. Yet, in spite of his undoubted brilliance, the newspapers said that the slightly built company promoter had a habit of overreaching himself, pointing to the 1923 liquidation of his Commercial Corporation of London and the collapse in 1926 of British Glass. Publicity over that unhappy venture was swiftly replaced by a vastly more important event, one that shook not only Hatry but also hundreds of thousands of his fellow countrymen. One sunny morning in May 1926, long lines of armored cars and thousands of armed troops poured into London. The Conservative government had mobilized all its resources to defeat the enemy, British organized labor. The Trades Union Congress had called a general strike, and 3.5 million union members stopped work on May 3rd. Public transport was halted. Factories, mines, and mills were shut. Most newspapers stopped production. In the days that followed, Hyde Park became a vast food storage center, protected, the New York World reported, by enough artillery to kill every living thing in every street in the neighborhood. Battleships were anchored off great ports like Liverpool and Southampton, guns trained on the quayside. These ominous military warnings were matched by equally belligerent policies. The Chancellor of the Exchequer, Winston Churchill, editing the official British Gazette, warned that any action taken by the armed forces will receive both now and afterwards the full support of His Majesty's government. Within hours, 30,000 more special constables had been enrolled to swell the total to 200,000. Police measures became draconian. In 6 days, 4,000 strikers were arrested. There were ugly riots in a dozen cities. The Flying Scotsman, the nation's most famous rail express, was derailed by saboteurs. Novelist Arnold Bennett, a close friend of Hatry's, confided that the fight would be short but violent, It was. It lasted 9 days, bringing Britain to the brink of revolution. It took a long time for the charm of the gay 20s to reassert itself. The strike over, Hattery prospered. His huge drapery and general investment trust became a part of Debenham's. His other front runner, Corporation and General Securities, issued £37 million in municipal loans. But all this was small beer for the venture the 39-year-old Hattery was about to embark upon. He planned to acquire the securities of the United Steel Companies for around £8 million. The companies controlled about 10% of Britain's iron and steel industry. Hattery then intended to amalgamate this group with still other independent iron and steel companies in a series of takeovers that would rationalize and modernize the entire industry. Eventually, he would resell the bumper merger to the public, earning for himself a handsome profit, while at the same time, in his view, doing the country a great service. Hattery's timing was impeccable. The steel industry was at a low ebb, as were other of the national export industries, coal, textiles, shipbuilding. Foreign competition and contraction of world markets were thought to be causing the increasing unemployment and decreasing profit. This recession in Britain was a major political issue. Hattery was not alone in believing that a general election must soon be fought on the crucial question of domestic policy. And already, Britain's Labour Party leader, Ramsay MacDonald, was giving broad hints that his platform would have two basic planks: the end of unemployment, and the restoration of national prosperity. And yet, the shrewd, far-sighted Hattery could also detect other indications that suggested this was the time to buy into the steel industry. There were hopeful signs for the country's economy, and the social advances of 1928 were continuing. 1929 would see new industrial consolidations, new suburbs created, and above all, an increase in the standard of living for everyone in work. The Central Electricity Board, a monopoly just 3 years old, would continue to replace the large number of small and inefficient power stations with superstations linked to a national grid, scheduled for completion in 1933. Already, the consumption of electricity in Britain had increased dramatically. 10 years before, only one house in 17 was wired. Now it was one in four, with another 250,000 consumers expected to be added during the year. Hattery believed, correctly, that the spread of electricity would mark an upturn for the steel industry, as other businesses were reallocated in green belt areas, especially around London. The auto and aircraft companies were already announcing expansion plans. The financier had also noticed that important developments were beginning to merge in patterns of trading and marketing. Goods were being prepackaged by the manufacturers rather than the shopkeepers. A retailing revolution, born in America, was starting to spread across the country. Its flag bearers were Woolworth, Marks and Spencer, Lipton, and Sainsbury. That, too, augured well for the future of the steel industry, which would supply all the tin for millions of cans of meat and fruit coming onto the supermarket shelves. Advertising, the importance of which Hattery was one of the quickest to spot, and the press, linked in a symbiotic relationship, each feeding off the other, were creating a demand for all kinds of consumer goods. And for those who could not afford to pay at once, credit facilities, Tick, the Slate, were becoming more readily available in even the depressed steel towns. All these were merely pointers, but to Hattery they confirmed that now was the time to move into steel. Yet there was a fatal flaw in his plan, a lack of ready money to achieve his ambitious goal. He would have to raise finance by one means or another. Raising money, though not for his private use, was relatively easy for Winston Churchill. As Britain's Chancellor of the Exchequer, he could do so merely by introducing new fiscal measures, Since 1924, he had produced 4 budgets, competently, but without his usual elan. He confided to friends of being mired in a bog of sums. Churchill had also brought Britain back onto the gold standard, suspended since 1919, because he believed it was essential for Britain's prosperity that the old economic values be restored. The Bank of England had warmly endorsed the decision. Germany and the United States had already returned to gold parity by the time Britain followed in 1925. His key role in the general strike embittered many workers. Churchill had defended his actions with a swinging, "I decline utterly to be impartial as between the fire brigade and the fire." In some Union quarters, hatred for him still persisted. But for Churchill, the strike was now history, material for his memoirs. Other matters of state crowded his days. The groundwork for his 5th budget, to be unveiled on April 1st, had to be laid. Churchill knew that a general election was in the offing. Therefore, he must deliver a fighting budget, which contained a set of vigorous new policies designed to appeal to the voters. If those proposals were favorably received, Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin could go to the hustings with confidence. The prospect of public political jousting always excited Churchill. Colleagues wondered if this was because of his American heritage. His mother was the daughter of a self-made New York businessman. Churchill greatly admired most things American, more so since his U.S. publisher had established him as a successful author. Nowadays, he earned more in America from his writing than he did as a cabinet minister. Almost 30 years had passed since he had last visited his mother's homeland. He was nearly 55 years old, a time for one of his periodic stock-takings. Politics was still his first love. But if he should lose office at the next election, then he would have a chance to indulge his next passion, travel. He would go to America to see old friends and to ask them to explain something he found fascinating as a politician and enticing as an investor, the spiraling bull market of Wall Street. Some 900 miles east of London, in the cramped offices of the Berlin Bureau of the Associated Press, reporter Louis Paul Lochner came to the conclusion that the countries of Europe shared almost a common view of what was happening on the American stock market, either unawareness or indifference. He knew this was not the story his editors in New York wished him to file. Their cable was quite specific. He was to collate reactions around Europe to booming Wall Street for a feature that would be a powerful reminder of how the old world was agog at what was happening in the new. From the outset, Lochner had trouble making facts fit that premise. Apart from Switzerland, almost every country was either beset by its own problems or preoccupied with the political and economic maneuvers of its neighbors. Russia was in its 5th year of Stalin's new economic policy. The Politburo, for the moment, content to accept Stalin's slogan of socialism in one country. There was no other alternative. Russia simply lacked the resources to carry the Bolshevik cause past other frontiers. The Soviets had barely returned to pre-revolution production. Food shortages were still rampant. The 1928 harvest was short by 2 million tons of the minimum amount of grain needed to feed the urban population. Reports reaching Lochner from Moscow showed Stalin far more preoccupied in January 1929 with having Trotsky exiled to Turkey than with the fluctuations of the Dow Jones Index. Lochner doubted whether anybody in Madrid had even heard of the index. He pondered that the only bulls Spaniards would be interested in were those that died in the Sunday afternoon corridas. Those spectacles were welcome relief from the political inertia that paralyzed the country. But if the parliamentary system had been badly bruised under the dictatorship of General Primo de Rivera, Spain was still undergoing economic expansion, financed in part by funds from France. The insular Spanish press devoted most of its space to covering dictator de Rivera's patriotic public speeches and carefully avoided mention of his private excesses, his drinking and lovemaking with gypsies, his stalking through the streets of Madrid in the small hours, swathed in an opera cloak and alcohol fumes. De Rivera was a tragicomic figure who would make an amusing character sketch on a dull news day for the energetic Lochner. The experienced reporter hadn't bothered to inquire about Wall Street in the Balkan states. The only time foreign journalists made inquiries among the Slavs, Croats, Slovenes, and Magyars was when their perpetual feuding turned toward full-scale war. Yugoslavia was gripped in yet another constitutional crisis. King Alexander had just appointed himself dictator. Italy, under Mussolini, was faced with growing problems that left no time for thoughts about a boom in Wall Street or anywhere. Industry and agriculture were already in recession. The prices index had started to fall. A series of currency revaluations had not stemmed the national mood of impending collapse. The few who held them could change a dollar for 19.07 lira. On the Milan Stock Exchange, a majestic six-story brownstone building near the city center, the 177 listed stocks moved sluggishly. Only 8 of them were foreign shares. None was American. Austria, in spite of a remarkable economic recovery from the World War, was still riven by a political crisis that had begun in July 1927 when leftists burned down the Palace of Justice in Vienna. The First Austrian Republic died in the flames. Since then, armed bands roamed the country, gathering numbers. In reporter Lochner's estimation, it would only be a matter of time before bloody civil war would engulf his favorite city, Vienna. He had not been surprised to learn that Swiss journalists were following attentively and commenting with lively interest on the events in Wall Street. This was in marked contrast to the attitude of his colleagues in the press, which served 40 million French people. Events on the New York Stock Exchange were not mentioned, nor was American stock listed in any of the Republic's newspapers. In this first month of 1929, France was an economic fortress with a balanced budget, an appreciable foreign trade surplus, full employment, a rise in living standards of 33% in the past 15 years, and the world's second highest gold reserves. Ruefully, Louis Lochner admitted that in insular France could indeed afford to be indifferent to the events in Wall Street. That left Germany. During his 5 years in Berlin, Louis Lochner had come to know Germany and its people as well as any foreign correspondent. His connections ranged from Foreign Minister Gustav Stresemann to lowly officials in far-off Bavaria. It was one of those who had tipped Lochner to keep a wary eye on a rabble-rouser in Munich named Adolf Hitler. But stories about a group of fanatics calling themselves Nazis and chanting anti-Semitic slogans were thought hardly newsworthy by Associated Press standards. Lochner had reported all the great milestones along Germany's road back to cautious acceptance after the World War. First, there had been the so-called Dawes Plan of 1924, which required the Germans to pay the Allies about $600 million every year in war reparations for an indefinite period. As security, the Allies assumed partial control of the German railroads and received part of the tax revenues on tobacco, sugar, beer, and alcohol. Now, in January 1929, Lochner had received a hint that the Germans planned to attend a meeting at The Hague with their former enemies to try and negotiate a more favorable final settlement. There was talk in Berlin of reducing the annual payments and letting them run for a set period, the year to end all reparations being mooted in Reichstag circles was 1988. The economic type stories that Lochner filed reflected the dramatically changing conditions Germany had experienced. His arrival in Berlin coincided with the peak of inflation. In 1923, the German mark reached the dizzy figure of 4.2 billion to the dollar. 4 years earlier, the exchange rate had been 8 to the dollar. As inflation soared, over 300 paper mills and 2,000 printing houses worked round the clock to supply the Reichsbank with paper money. Yet, in one of the most spectacular recoveries in economic history, a year later, Germany was one of the great industrial nations of the world. The short reason for this miracle was that the country had become a prime field for foreign investment. An unprecedented flow of capital, mainly from the United States in the form of short and long-term loans, enabled German corporations to build new factories and assembly lines. State and city governments floated loans to subsidize parks and theaters. Even churches borrowed to build more churches. Some foreign investors were beginning to withdraw their money from Wall Street in order to invest it in Germany, where interest rates were far higher than those prevailing in the United States. One of Lochner's early reports had shown how the country had absorbed not only American capital, but American know-how in management and efficiency. Productivity increased and wages rose. The latest figures showed unemployment at an insignificant 650,000. But the nation's foreign debt had swollen to $7 billion, much of it in short-term, high-interest loans. To pay that off, Germany was even now looking for more money abroad. The warning to Wall Street was clear. Reporter Lochner began to type his story. Directly south of Berlin, in the graceful village of Berchtesgaden, deep in the snow-bound Bavarian Alps, Adolf Hitler had received further evidence to support the two most ingrained convictions that sustained him, the danger from Jews and Germany's need for Lebensraum, increased living space. Nazi Party membership now stood at 100,000, attracting anti-communists and all those who believed the Reich must acquire new territory or perish at the hand of the Jewish menace. Looking out of his villa window to the twin mountain peaks that dominated the view, Hitler had come to the conclusion that the principal tasks that faced him were really interwoven. He must obtain Lebensraum in the East and at the same time annihilate the Jews. His recent speeches had increasingly raised the specter of racial degeneration unless those aims were achieved. Now he had something further to fan the flames. His faithful Joseph Goebbels had obtained from America evidence that the Nazis were not alone in castigating world Jewry. For years, one of the most distinguished of all Americans had waged a bitter and relentless public campaign against the Jews. His anti-Semitism was only equaled by his hatred of Wall Street. His name was Henry Ford. Chapter 3. The Dealer Wheelers. Standing in a works manager's office, Henry Ford, the unsuspecting recipient of Hitler's gratitude, looked down on a scene that provided him satisfaction. It afforded living proof that the automobile industry was thriving, that the newspapers were not exaggerating when they said there were more cars on the streets of New York than there were in the whole of Europe. Beyond the gates, guarded by his own private police force, thousands of men were corralled in an open parking lot. Ankle deep in icy slush, they shuffled toward the entrance to the Rouge plant, the largest of the Ford Motor Company factories in Detroit. Some of them had been coming to the lot since January 2, 1929. On that day, Ford announced he would begin hiring the first of 30,000 additional workers he needed at the Rouge. 400 men every day would be taken on to meet an unprecedented demand for his cars and trucks. Tens of thousands of workless had hurried to Detroit. The response was another sign of the city's reputation as the Mecca of high wages, and an omen that elsewhere in the nation, in spite of the booming stock market, employment was falling. Those fortunate enough to be hired, at 62.5 cents an hour, they were among the highest paid manual workers in the land, found themselves in the most spotless auto plant in the world. Cleanliness was one of Ford's many obsessions. 5,000 men were engaged continuously in keeping the plant spick and span. Every month, they used 11,000 gallons of eggshell white and 5,000 gallons of machine blue paint. The colors were chosen by Ford, who believed them beneficial for maintaining order and morale, another of his fixations. He also specified the amount of soda to be mixed with the boiling water for scrubbing floors. Trash cans were emptied, on his orders, every 120 minutes, on the dot, around the clock. An intricate network of suction pipes kept the rouge air dust-free. Another obsession, one that even brought grudging admiration from the unions, still trying unsuccessfully to force Ford to declare a closed shop, was his attempt to reduce the hazards of the assembly line. From the day he had introduced mass production, Ford was aware that the steady clack-clack of machinery and the soothing whir of wheels as men performed repetitive motions could induce carelessness. A multiplicity of bells, locks, shields, signs, and blood-red paint warned of danger on all machinery capable of cutting or crushing a worker. While Ford had not been able to ban the fatigue and monotony of the shop floor, he had the best safety record in the industry and probably in the whole country. Another of his fears was that suddenly an epidemic might halt production. One infected worker could spread illness like wildfire. For years now, all telephones, goggles, respirators, and like sources of infection were sterilized every day. Company regulations insisted that the slightest scratch or pinprick, or even a trifling indisposition, be reported immediately to one of the first aid stations dotted around the plant. A worker returning from the World War said there were more casualties stationed at Ford's than he'd seen on the battlefield of France. A well-staffed hospital, the envy of any outside community, was on permanent standby close to the assembly lines. Even the natural elements came under Ford's scrutiny. He ordered a uniform temperature for all drinking water, between 55 degrees and 60 degrees. Ford also calculated that every worker needed 30 cubic feet of fresh air each minute in order to work at full capacity. Ducts ensured the rouge atmosphere changed 60 times an hour. Well arranged, managed, and maintained, the plant was an extension of its owner, still intently watching the men in the parking lot. Sharecroppers from Georgia, Mexican beet pickers, unemployed coal miners from Kentucky, and farm workers from all over the Midwest had arrived at 4 a.m., hoping to be hired. Whether they would be depended on what the New York Times compared to a lottery. Ford's hiring agents resorted to a 10-in, 10-out method of selection. The 10 men closest to the factory door were taken in for inspection, the second 10 arbitrarily told to go away, the third 10 admitted. The rejection of every even 10 men cost them, for no apparent reason, the chance to work that they had won by standing in the snow most of the preceding night. On the first days, fighting had broken out as the desperate men strove to be in the right position when they reached the gates. The guards doused them with fire hoses. Some of the men began to freeze where they stood. They were either taken to hospitals or struggled to a local 10-cent movie house where, the Times man noted, they were not so much interested in the show as in keeping warm. After thawing out, they would return to the car park, once again hoping to be hired. Henry Ford was pleased to see that on this morning, order was being strictly maintained by the guards. he congratulated the bouncy little man at his elbow. Harry Herbert Bennett was listed on the company's books as head of personnel. In reality, he ran one of the largest private armies in the United States, some 3,000 hand-picked guards capable of instilling fear in even the toughest of workers. Bennett himself had an infallible way of dealing with an uppity employee. He simply beat him senseless. He could flatten a man twice his size. This morning, the bantam cock Bennett had left his closely guarded bunker near the main gates to join his master. As usual, he wore a bow tie, a legacy of the day he was nearly strangled in a fight by his own necktie. In his waistband, he carried a brace of pistols. Recently, he had shot a cigar from the mouth of a visitor who had ignored a warning that smoking was forbidden at the plant. On another occasion, he put a couple of bullets through a visitor's boater because Bennett didn't like straw hats. To keep up his marksmanship, he regularly sat behind his desk and blasted away at a 6-inch steel target set up on a filing cabinet at the opposite end of the room. For weeks, he had kept a pair of caged tigers in his office and threatened to feed them with any employee who proved too recalcitrant. Ford adored his thuggish henchman because, "If I want something done, he will do it. I don't have to tell him twice." His salary, paid out of Ford's own pocket, no hardship for a man whose personal income in 1928 had reached $136,000 a day, ensured that Bennett was answerable only to Ford. In his service, he had recruited convicts and professional bruisers to join the retired athletes who completed his battalions. Between them, they spied and informed on and bullied the company's 90,000 other employees. In his perennially blue shirt, Bennett seemed to be everywhere, quelling the first hint of trouble, driving on the assembly workers, getting things done. When he was not prowling the plants, Bennett flitted between the 5 mansions he maintained around Detroit. At the one on Gross Isle, a pseudo-Oriental palace, he had a covered dock. Moored inside was a steel-hulled yacht, prepared for a quick getaway, should Bennett ever meet more trouble than even he could handle. Today there was no sign of trouble. The lines of unemployed continued meekly to move forward. Dressed in his regular gray wool suit, his feet enclosed in expensive shoes, one of the few luxuries he permitted himself, Henry Ford could view with satisfaction the columns of men in the car park. His instinctive flair for publicity had again worked. Already it had made him the most widely discussed man of his time. 15 full-length books on his life and work had appeared in the past 9 years. A further 14 had been largely devoted to him. No other American had ever received such attention during his life. Ford's own name appeared as an author on the title page of 3 volumes. The most successful was Good Morning. After a sleep of 25 years, old-fashioned dancing is being revived by Mr. and Mrs. Henry Ford. It had sold 50,000 copies and become a standard work in its field. With the same folksy and, said his enemies, foxy approach that had made him a hero to the dance masters of America, Ford had now reaffirmed himself as the media's favorite answer to the workless. Firmly entrenched where he believed he belonged, center stage, leaving all his rivals in the auto industry trailing by thousands of column inches of invaluable free publicity, Henry Ford could, for the moment, turn away from work problems to ponder more relaxing thoughts. His dream of creating a memorial to those he most admired in the evolution of America was soon to come true. 2 years had passed since he announced his decision to build an industrial museum in Dearborn for his collection of cars. A year later, he revealed plans to supplement the museum with an early American village, where he would exhibit original buildings and inventions, spanning several stages of American life or linked with important events and persons, including himself. For a man who thought the only way to preserve his sturdy growth of hair was to comb it with salt water, that granulated sugar was dangerous because the sharp edges of its crystals cut into the blood vessels, that jails and hospitals would be made obsolete once people learned to eat the things they should, the idea of creating what would be one of the world's largest private monuments was not unreasonable. Greenfield Village, at its planned public opening October 21st, would cover over 200 acres, testimony that money, as Ford often said, could buy anything except a way to rid himself of enemies. Over the years, these had been many, but two remained constant at the top of his hate list, Jews and Wall Street. Perhaps Ford's anti-Semitism had always been there, an extension of those other phobias that had riddled him from childhood on that 90-acre farm near the village of Dearbornville, Michigan. He was born July 30, 1863, into a world where the dead of the Civil War were still being buried. His hatred of war, claimed the mythmakers, stemmed from that accident of birth. His health fads were rooted in his sickly childhood, when he was frequently gripped with the ague. His dislike of farming was a direct result of having to shovel manure. Coddled by his mother, indulged by his hard-working father, Henry went his own way. His mechanical bent was evident early on, but his turbulent emotions, his desire for revenge, his habit of making judgments based on obsessions rather than facts, began to grow as his fame grew. His wife, Clara, whom he married in 1888, remained totally loyal to his whims and caprices. She bought his clothes, soothed his ego, listened as he waged verbal war against those he imagined had wronged him. Somewhere along the way, his enemies became epitomized by Jews. He first publicly attacked them in 1916, suddenly accusing them of starting the Great War. "They have cornered all the basic materials needed to fight the war and all that, and until the Jews stop the war, it cannot be stopped." The 1918 armistice did not end Ford's intolerance. He blamed the Jews for the post-war crime wave, for the inefficiency of the peacetime Navy, even for the poor state of the candy bar industry. "The Jews have taken hold of it. They're cheapening it to make more money out of it." Above all, it was the Jews who were wrecking his idea of what the American way of life should be, particularly by their obnoxious use of credit. The fact that installment buying had created an almost insatiable demand for cars did not interest Ford. Borrowing money was bad, and that was that. In November 1920, Ford bought a local weekly, the Dearborn Independent, which gave him a platform to wage an unfettered, virulent attack against the Jews and their frontmen, the greedy bankers of Wall Street. Under such inflammatory headlines as "The International Jew, the World's Problem," the Independent set out to disrupt the lives of 3.3 million Jews living in North America in rare tranquility. Week after week, the Jew-baiting continued. The Jews retaliated with a boycott of Ford cars, trucks, and tractors. Many Gentiles joined the boycott out of sympathy. "Their action," said Ford derisively, "was a bit like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic after it had been holed." Sales of the Independent soon reached 500,000. Copies found their way to Germany, where Hitler was writing Mein Kampf. The future
Fuhrer. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.